Well, hey there, Felicia. It's me, Hermit, Kermit's brother. I'm a turtle, which is just a frog with a shell. And I'm here to tell you a little secret. You see this balloon I've got? It's a birthday telegram, and I've got a cute little song to sing to you, for this is your birthday episode. Wow. Are you ready? I don't know if I am. When you are so happy, it almost makes you sad, because you know that happiness is fleeting, and everyone's receding, and we all turn to dust in the end. Happy birthday! Okay, I have to go to my happy little cluster of friends. Bye!
Thanks, Hermit. Elaine, did you order that for me? Did you order Hermit?
You got me.
Kermit's brother, the singing telegram.
I tried to make it a mystery, but I got a great Groupon for it, and I couldn't resist. Because I know you love the Muppets, and Hermit was a little cheaper because he's not
Muppets.
Like a true Muppet, but I know how much you love the Muppets, so I wanted to do that for you.
I mean, I did love that. I don't know for the reasons that you wanted me to love it, but I did love it.
I do a lot of things on this podcast that I know I'll regret 20 years from now. Like, somehow it'll resurface and they'll be like, Elaine, you did that. And when we record these, it's a fever dream. Like, half the time I don't remember, like, the shit we say, the shit I say and do.
Yeah.
Until someone like responds to us and I'm like, oh my god, I'm a
That's
but
true.
Enough about me. This is your birthday episode, and Felicia, what are we gonna do on your birthday episode?
This is a little bit early, but in around 5 days after this episode comes out, I'm turning 20.
A new decade.
A new number. Ooh. I get a new number, ladies and gents. What we're doing for my birthday is something that I go to when I'm stressed. And I think the thing is I normally do this when I'm incredibly stressed out and things aren't going great for me. And right now things are going well for me. And I found it wasn't as much of a soothing balm as it is when I'm incredibly stressed. But hey, that's good. That means things are going well.
Yeah.
Today we're making the official, if Wonka was a Muppet movie, what Muppet would play what character? And by Wonka, I mean Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, because we don't know enough about the Wonka new movie to really do that yet. Putting the cart before the horse.
Fantastic.
The insane thing is one of our listeners messaged us on Instagram, our listener Grace, and said, hey, have you guys done a Muppet Wonka cast literally like 5 days ago? And we've had this plan for a while.
Wild.
So I am impressed with your
Wonka psychic ability.
Foresight, I guess.
Must have heard the echoes from the well.
The way we're doing this is I have prepared the Wonka casting. I'm going to be screen sharing with Elaine and she will describe the Muppets, because listening to Elaine describe Muppets is one of my favorite activities, personally. There's something about
it. Because I'm
that
not
is just so
familiar with Muppets. I know the big hitters.
Exactly.
And
I'm gonna have you to settle some things that I couldn't decide on. You
wow,
know.
Lovely.
I'm back, and
Hermit!
I forgot something I was supposed to give to you. Here, it's a mysterious bundle of papers. Tip?
Oh,
yay! Do you have any arcade coins?
Is this a birthday card?
I delivered it to you. Arcade coins. I love the arcade. Ping. Fine, whatever.
What's your favorite game
of
the arcade? I was going to give it to you! What's your favorite game of the arcade, Hermit?
You know, I like the ones that are little motorcycles, and you go, wee.
Oh, those are fun.
Because
all right.
Turtle,
here's an
I
old
could never
Chuck
drive.
Cheese coin I have from 2007.
Wow. Yep, it's real. Thank you so much, and again, have a lovely birthday. Goodbye.
Hermit's everybody's new favorite character.
This is like D&D when you make an NPC and everyone loves it, but it was like just someone on the you didn't give a shit about, and suddenly you have to create an entire backstory.
Oh my god, in this bundle of papers, not a birthday card, so
rude,
but we do have our Wonka Watch news, and I have two things today.
Wow.
The first thing is, believe it or not, another update on the counterfeit Wonka bars. It's been a while, ladies and gents.
Oh my gosh.
But we have an update. Guess what? There's a crown trial set over selling 1,237 boxes of fake Wonka bars.
Boxes.
A Watford man will face a crown court trial over allegedly selling that many Wonka bars. According to court documents, one of the charges relates to unhygienic surroundings involving bars being unsealed and pest activity.
Oh,
this is from the Watford Observer. He was also charged with possessing or controlling material bearing a false trademark and possessing goods with a false trademark intending to sell them, again, for chocolate bars. The location for all charges is given as Luton, and the boxes were allegedly sold between May 2021 and March 2022.
Wow.
It's just been a while. And it was, you know, nice to hear.
Justice
that
is so
fake Wonka
sweet.
Bars were being brought to justice.
Oh my gosh. That's... I can't believe I love getting updates on the story, though, because it's so bizarre to me that no one knew
that this has just been this ongoing unfolding
story.
Yeah,
that apparently it was this easy to do it. But what about the vapes? What about all those vapes?
I know. What about the vapes in the phone cases?
what about those?
And now we're going to talk about this article from Gaming Ideology, which I think has some AI-generated qualities
to it.
This article is called France Takes Center Stage with Hugh Grant as Oompa Loompa in Spectacular Wonka, A Journey Back to Charlie and the Chocolate Factory Origins.
No, whoa, whoa.
Nearly 2 years after the Wonka movie was announced, new announcements were made during CinemaCon 2023 in Las Vegas. Unfortunately, the trailer images have still not been released to the public. However, according to reliable sources, we now have a glimpse of the highly anticipated film. In the trailer, we see Wonka, nose to nose, with one of the Oompa Loompas, these very important characters in the story of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, who is played here by the talented Hugh Grant. Following the trailer, Hugh Grant, who plays an Oompa Loompa in the film, expressed his excitement at the event. He said, "This is the first time people see Hugh Grant as an Oompa Loompa, isn't it? It was a journey. And Hugh Grant is one of the greatest, so it was a dream come true for me." That's a Timothy Chalamet quote. That is not a Hugh Grant quote.
I was like, that's weird for him to talk about himself that way.
Imagine if he said that, though, for real. It would be the funniest fucking thing.
It'd be amazing. What could you say to it? You'd be like, "You're not wrong, I suppose. That's just how it goes.
This is the first time people see Hugh Grant as an Oompa Loompa, isn't it?" And Hugh Grant is one of the greatest. So then there's a title that says, "A film that traces the life of an emblematic character," like, on the inside, which then it basically rephrases the upper part of the article with, like, it says everything twice, and it, like, gives, like, oh, here are the two other movies and the ratings they got on Rotten Tomatoes. Cool. But then you get this last two paragraphs, which is baffling. "By providing these comprehensive details, the article ensures that readers are well informed about the latest updates on the Wonka movie. Additionally, the use of engaging HTML headlines such as 'New updates on Wonka movie revealed at CinemaCon 2023' and 'The film that traces the life of an emblematic character' helps capture the reader's attention and makes the content more visually appealing. Furthermore, the article encourages user engagement by piquing the reader's curiosity about the upcoming Wonka movie. It highlights the anticipation surrounding the film and presents the readers with an opportunity to share their excitement and expectations in the comics or through social media platforms."
What?
So there's some AI fuckery going on here, because it seems like somebody was rephrase this article and make it explain to me why it's good?
Yeah, and they just pasted it all together. That's uncomfy.
Because there is an article from EuroDayFR.com that came out the same day, which is titled "France and Hugo Loompa and Hugh Grant as Oompa Loompa will be in the spotlight." They didn't say Hugo Loompa, but still isn't caught on. Which is essentially the same article phrased slightly differently without the things at the bottom. So either the second article is plagiarized or it's somebody who, like, wrote both of them and wanted to adjust it. But here's the fucked up thing. Neither of these articles ever mention France. First word in both of the titles. France takes center stage. France and Hugh Grant and Oompa Loompa will be in spotlight.
But then there's no France. Hmm.
I'd like to know if this is going on in France. That would be helpful.
Yes.
Like, that would be cool to know if it's set in France. Nope, not helpful.
We still have time, everybody. We have time before AI takes us all out.
It made me feel a little better. You're right. Wonka casting time. I want to talk a little bit about my Muppet casting philosophy, which is fucking crazy, but that is a thing I have. In my opinion, when I Muppet cast, I try to look beyond the obvious choice because I think it's more fun to come up with, like, some alternate takes, you know? I normally include, like, Sesame Street or anything under the Jim Henson canon, but this time I was able to keep it, like, 99% Muppet, which is good. Yeah, I know. I talk about this like I'm doing fine art or like I'm a scholar.
It's amazing.
Which is, you know, what I am. So,
yeah.
I'm getting my master's. I've been really interested in puppets for a very long time, but weirdly mostly about like puppet making techniques. So I have not seen every Muppet movie because it's a treat for me, okay? I'm savoring them.
Oh, wow. How long are you trying to make them last?
I don't
know. Are you going, how many decades?
I'm not sure.
Wow.
But I'm going to be screen sharing with Elaine my thoughts and opinions as we go. And we're going to try and extend this for a full episode.
I believe in us. Tangents are allowed, and I've never been more... I mean, tangents are...
Always allowed, but they're encouraged today.
They're very much encouraged, and I'm ready.
So, for this, I wanted to do primarily 1971, because it really has the closest vibe to a Muppet movie. And okay, normally when I do these, I'll work over, like, the course of a week and cast every single character that appears on screen. I didn't do that this time, just because... I decided if it wasn't coming to me, it wasn't right. And also, I only started it yesterday.
Perfect.
But yeah, 1971, I feel like as I've gone on, I used to be kind of a proponent for the Johnny Wonka movie. I'm no longer. I want to just formally say that. I'm now a 1971 girl.
Wow.
I enjoy Welcome. Aspects. I mean, I think Watch we've just, that. We've, I've noticed that every time we refer to characters, if we're talking like neutrally, we're talking about 1971, unless it's Mike TV, and then it's 2005.
Right.
Like that's, I've just
I
noticed
just about to say.
What we yeah. do. And I think I did yeah, that on this PowerPoint fair. Too. First, I did cast some Wonka Watch favorite characters that are not Wonka characters, oh, but I just goodness. Wanted to mention.
My quick question, how many Muppets are there?
Okay, so here's the thing. We can
Oh no.
So hold on, let me look at my Muppet casting database because this is a thing I have. So on Notion, I have a database that I use to categorize all the Muppets by vibes and physical features to make this task easier. I had this made already. I did not make this for this purpose.
No, Felicia, but you already made it.
Yeah.
Which is fine, but I like that your defense was, no, I already made it.
I wanted to make it clear that I didn't make
so
it.
So that makes it
this.
Better. It's like, it doesn't matter, but it would be the same thing either way because you did make
it. So here's the thing. I consider anything made by the Jim Henson Company fair game. Like, I got a Bear in the Big Blue House mm-hmm. Muppet on here because sometimes I cast, Perf. Like, full shows sometimes. So, like, I did the entire, every single character that appeared on screen in Hannibal during a rough moment of my life. I have 168. That's incomplete,
oh
though.
Oh, my God.
Muppets
oh
specifically.
God.
There's eight. I have them sorted by prominence. There's eight that I consider celebrities, 17 that are highly prominent, 16 that are middle ground, and 27 who are pretty niche, and 16 who are indescribably niche.
Wow.
But yeah, no if there's idea. A Muppet with glasses, I can just do a little Google and I can find him.
That's amazing.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, wow. Well, so yeah, again, I don't know Muppets as well, so I will be describing a lot of them to people, and I can't wait to hear some of their backstories.
First up, for Private Detective Investigator Milano Tollhouse, I felt like Zoot was correct. So Zoot is a member of the Electric Mayhem. He's the one with the saxophone. He's just very fucking cool. He wears a fedora. He's got sunglasses.
I love him. Oh my god!
I don't have much more to say about this. I just feel like he could do Private Detective Investigator Milano Tollhouse justice.
He reminds
justice.
Me of like, wow, go on a journey with me. Blue raspberry flavored ramen that got to have an Eat, Pray, Love moment and then found joy in the saxophone that finally like gave it peace.
Wow. I love that. That's great.
So it begins.
Yeah. All right. I did cast Amari Guishon as Wade.
Oh my god. God.
Wayne, sorry, that's Wayne. So he's one half of Wayne and Wanda. They're like this couple who do dances and sing songs.
Oh my god.
But he's just Wayne. Amari, there's the difficulty with Muppet casting is when you come to people who are like just some guy. That's the problem. Because there are some people who just don't have very Muppetish qualities and it can be extremely difficult to cast them. Violet Beauregard was fucking hard, I'm gonna tell y'all. And you wouldn't think she'd be hard, but it's difficult. It's not easy.
I imagine. This Muppet reminds me of, like, if Fred Astaire
yes.
became a Muppet. The nose on this guy is a little scary. It looks like it's
Are you talking about
prominent.
Amari Guishon or Wayne?
Wayne. Like, Wayne almost has a beak, but it looks soft at the same time. Mm-hmm. It's a little confusing. But he's very dapper. And I bet he's really good at tap dancing.
Yep, exactly. But no, yeah, I feel like Amari Guishani kind of has the element of like celebrity. He's kind of above it all, you know? Like he's a little bit fancier than everybody else. So Fickle Gerber would be Kermit. I mean, I feel like that's obvious. It's not even like a note. It's of just course. Like he's a frog. And blah, blah, blah.
Look at this. I bet they're best friends.
Gourmand Eustace Petrickle III would be the Swedish chef. And I just wanted to put that out there because I didn't have the Swedish chef represented in here. And I realized... Like, that's Gourmand Eustace Petrickle III, which we haven't brought up in a while.
No, he's can the you perfume... remind everybody who that is?
Yeah, he's the perfume magnet that I invented in the pitching new Wonka characters episode, which was like 30 episodes ago. Like, that was a long time ago now. That feels... Gourmand feels so recent to me.
Oh, Swedish Chef. Okay, I do recall this Muppet. This Muppet has no eyes, which makes me happy that he would wield a knife at some point. I feel like this Muppet would give good hugs, but I would be afraid to receive a hug because I also am a little afraid of puppets.
Yeah.
But this Muppet looks very silly and nice.
He does try to kill the chickens a lot.
Oh, well, he's got the fancy little chef hat too and his little bow tie with his apron.
Side characters. We're going into the side characters of the 1971 movie. The first one was the computer guy. I fucking agonized over the computer guy because I think the original thing is you think Beaker because he's like a science experiment. But I don't know. There's something a little bit more composed about the computer guy in the beginning. I had Grover on there momentarily because Grover always tries to help people and it goes wrong. But then I was like, no, let's keep it fucking simple. We're doing Scooter. Because I could see Scooter getting frustrated at the machine. I was thinking, like, who could get fresh? I've, like, really thought about this really hard. Scooter is a personal fave of mine. He's kind of like a Kermit light.
What, Elaine? Like, he kind of reminds me of you. like, in your youth. Like,
yeah,
and I don't know what I mean by that, but there's some kind of energy where I'm like,
I have small eyes and they are close together.
It's just you have had that smile before, which is so funny. Like, it's just a delightful little smile. And I've seen Felicia, when I was visiting Felicia, showed me some of the home video plays that she used to make with her friends on stage and write. And so much theatrical stuff, and this just looks like somebody who might have been a stage manager on one of those productions.
That's what he is. I love stage manager for the Muppets.
Oh my gosh! Well, look at that. And his clipboard does look like a piece of chocolate. So he's got, oh my gosh, he's a cute little orange melon, and he's got his cute little like tracksuit sweatshirt.
Bomber
going
jacket.
On. It's very Absolutely. Snazzy. Bomber jacket, snazzy, and yes, little glass eye thing.
Cheeto hair.
Cheeto hair, yes.
But yeah, no, I feel good about the computer guy, a Scooter. And then also, Agreed. The computer itself would be played by 80s Robot. Because I was like, come on, we got to get 80s Robot in there.
Whoa. I wasn't ready for the computer to get casted.
Yeah, well, it just Amazing. I felt like I had to. The 80s Robot just kind of looks like the computer. for
Amazing.
80s
what is
robot.
This prom photo he's doing? Felicia's showing a photo of this robot, and then Kermit's there, and like they look like they're doing a prom pose.
You're so right.
A JCPenney photo shoot for Christmas cards? I don't know, but it's an energy that's intriguing. And
I love that. Yeah, but 80s so Robot good. Is like shit at like giving them directions in the Muppet 2011 film.
Okay,
so Slugworth, I decided would be played by Uncle Deadly. I briefly considered the Count, but I thought Uncle Deadly was like the obvious and good choice. Uncle Deadly, he was in the movie we watched. Uncle Deadly's one of my favorite Muppets. I think he's so fucking cool.
I hate him.
He's kind of like a kid's cartoon version of, you know how in when Pirates of the Caribbean, when the pirates turn into skeletons at night?
Yes.
He's kind of got that vibe. He's kind of like a Captain really Barbossa does. About him. He's like a dragon. But Uncle Deadly is like has an intimidating appearance, but he's really nice. And I feel like that's a good combo for Slugworth, you know?
Yeah, I definitely agree with this. I forgot how not a fan I am of Uncle Deadly because evil pointy eyes. Like, this is what hides in your closet. You know,
I am comforted
like,
by him.
A little antsy. Of course you are. I don't even... What does that say about you? I don't know. Like, in the best of ways.
In the Muppet 2011 movie, he is on the bad guys team until the end when he has a moment where he wants to save the Muppets. in this beautiful cinematic shot where he, like, stops the bad guy. And I got emotionally attached to him because of that.
Are these metal things on the side of his face or, like, whiskers or...
Yeah, they're whiskers. They're, like, saliva? Feathers. They blow in the wind.
Ew! I hate that. But good. It's like if Gonzo... 50 years later,
Gonzo had a real rough patch. Shadow self.
Yes, yes! Gonzo shadow self.
I want to say for,
I like this.
For reference, the only Muppet movie Elaine has seen in full is the 2011 movie, and we did a commentary on it, which is on our Buy Me a Coffee. So if you want to see more of me gushing over the Muppets and talking about incredibly niche details, and Elaine, I do believe you called Statler and Waldorf Stalin and Meth Head, which I think about a lot.
Yes.
And you also, when you saw Animal, you said he looks like pastrami.
It was a wild time, guys.
Yeah.
Highly recommend.
Okay, so Mr. Turkentine, the teacher, which I always forget he has a name, I thought about this really hard. I also got stuck on this, but I decided he would be played by both Beaker and Bunsen Honeydew, like, together, because they do that in Muppet movies a lot, where they're, like, joined and hang out, you know?
Amazing.
And because he does all the experiments that go wrong, and it felt perfect, and it was like, that captures it for me.
It really does.
This took me more than an hour to make.
I could... Well, you don't have a lot to work off of, you know? Like, these characters
I thought you were
going to
say, you don't have a lot going on. The work fills the time.
What? Oh, my gosh. You have very limited scenes to pull from.
Yeah.
I highly enjoy this.
It didn't take
this.
Me an hour
Bunsen
just
Honeydew.
To do this. I'm saying the full thing. Let me clarify.
Oh, okay. I feel better now. I was kind of going with it for you, but I was concerned that you would spend a whole hour deciding the Muppets for this gentleman. So that's better. I wasn't judging you, but I was going to be a little concerned and maybe chat with you after this. Let's just see how things are going.
All right. Come off your high horse, Miss Planet Zoo.
Whoa. It's fair. We all have our dark, dark secrets.
Elaine texting me about the secret. Bat museum she's making in the Bucket Family Shack.
I really like this. I do hate Bunsen Honeydew.
I actually don't really love Bunsen and Beaker either. They kind of freak me out, personally.
Oh, I love Beaker. I love Beaker. Beaker might be my favorite Muppet.
Wow.
Like, and I don't know why, but
I feel
Beaker...
like I'm on a journey to loving Beaker. I just don't authentically love him.
Oh, yeah. I just, meep, meep, meep. Oh, it's so cute. Oh, and he runs around. Maybe I relate to him a lot. There's just a running around and screaming, but nonsense. No one understands what Beaker's saying.
Yeah.
Bunsen Honeydew doesn't really look like he has a mouth. I know he does, but he has no eyes.
I mean, he looks like a honeydew.
And is just, he looks like a honeydew, and I don't like honeydew.
All right, so Grandpa Joe... We have options. I think he would be played by Waldorf of Statler and Waldorf. Now, the traditional Muppet thing would be to have Waldorf play Grandpa Joe and Statler play Grandpa George, and they'd both go into the factory with him because, like, in the Muppets Christmas Carol, they had the Statler and Waldorf play Bob Marley.
Oh, my God.
Is that the character's name? Is it Bob Marley?
Bob Cratchit?
Jacob Marley.
Jacob Marley. Sorry. Yes. It's like, Bob Marley is a different person.
I'm like,
person.
I know it's a different person, but I know the last name is Marley. But also, alternatively, wow. I think there's a good evidence to be made for Grandpa Joe being a human man and Charlie also being a human boy. You know?
Very. Yes. I can see that, too. Yeah, because the main characters tend to be humans in these things.
Exactly.
Right? When they involve
so
that storyline.
I still like to put out a Muppet cast anyway, because I think it's more fun that way.
I enjoy this a lot. They look so similar. It's a little eerie. Like, you just change the suit on Waldorf, and you're set.
Give him a little hat. He's
and
done.
And the sass? Perfect.
Exactly. It's the same gruffness. Waldorf probably has a gambling problem. It's perfect. All right, Grandma Georgina, this is a really niche pick, but I put her as Grandma Flutter, a.k.a. Tutter's grandma from Bear in the Big Blue House.
Whoa.
I'm not applying family logic.
Whoa.
This is a visual casting. Whoa. But it just felt right. Whoa. Grandma Flutter, I remember the episode. She was just fucking nuts. Had a lot of energy and reminded me of Grandma Georgina, who's the icon who slaps Willy Wonka in the face. Oh, no, she grabs him
Fantastic.
And shakes him in the Great Glass Elevator. And I just wanted to put some respect on her name. So she's being played by Grandma Flutter.
I didn't know Grandma Flutter was a thing. I loved Big Bear in the Big Blue House. Big Bear in the Big Blue House. Because I think I've said this before. I thought, what was his name?
Bear?
It's been a while. But I loved him so much because he looked like a chicken tender. and I wanted to hug him.
Okay, Grandpa George. I didn't cast Grandma Josephine because I couldn't think of one, and I didn't want to make myself. But here's the thing. Logic would say it would be Statler. And I think if this was an actual Muppets production, it would be Statler, and that's fine. But I wanted to bring attention to Sam Eagle as an alternate. I love Sam Eagle. Mm. He's, you know, the guy from Parks and Rec.
Ron Swanson?
Yes. That's Sam Eagle. Sam Eagle is essentially Ron Swanson. Oh. He's just very patriotic. He's definitely conservative. Very patriotic.
Oh, well then, yeah.
Grandpa George is typically very stern in the books, if I'm remembering correctly. So I just thought this would be a good place to throw in Sam Eagle. Because I couldn't really find a place for him otherwise.
Statler has always cracked me up as, like, the depressed, angry version of Big Bird.
That's Sam Eagle. Statler is the old man on the right.
Oh, wow.
That would make sense, wouldn't it?
Sam Eagle. Statler looks like a name that would fit
Sam He does Eagle also better. Look like this, a Statler. This depressed. But it would be weird if the right. man was named Sam Eagle, not the bird.
Well, I don't know. Maybe not. I'm... Anyway, Sam Eagle, the sad, depressed bluebird. I feel like this is an outfit that Sam Eagle is wearing, which is presumably just his body. Mm-hmm. But I feel like this is something I've seen on Drag Race before.
Yeah.
You know?
I am American, American.
But yes, I fully agree with this.
I feel like there's potential. But yeah, Statler, if we're going real Muppet movie, but if we're just going loosey-goosey off the walls, Sam Eagle. Because I just want him to be there.
Yes.
Okay, last is the Tinkerman of the side characters. And I have presented either the Undertaker or Crazy Harry.
Oh, Crazy Harry returns once more.
I guess we talked about him on the Pop Tropica. I don't know if it was in our Buy Me a Coffee or on the episode, but Crazy Harry just, he has a lot of hair.
Yeah, he does.
He likes to blow things up.
Like Coke. Yeah, I get that.
He kind of looks like Charlie scary. From It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
Wow, yes.
It's the coat.
Whole mouth of teeth, too.
Yeah.
So many teeth. A little scary for a puppet to have teeth.
Yeah.
You ever think about that?
He is
I'm not a fan
spooky.
Of that. A little spooky. Little.
And we have the Undertaker. He's from A Muppet's Christmas Carol. He is a, like, 1 second character who shows up only for this, where, like, I think he's selling, like, jewelry of Scrooge's. Or
it's
something.
A similar vibe to a man who sells knives.
And there's
and
something
shows up
a little
briefly.
Bit more like foreboding about him than Crazy Harry. I felt like Crazy yes. Harry was a little bit too unhinged.
I like Undertaker. I like both of these options, but I feel like Undertaker, based on what you've just said, really does fit the energy. I love the assorted photos Felicia has gathered. The screenshot of Tinkerman, which if you've seen our TikToks, you'll know the screenshot, but it's the Tinkerman with the widest eyes.
Right, so he looks definitely more in the like middle. Crazy Harry, which is the problem with this.
Yes.
But I think the Undertaker yes. fits it more tonally.
He looks like he just learned that, like, World War II has begun or something. I don't
literally.
Know. He's just a very, like, you know, like, he's like, oh! Or, like, Dillard's is having a half-off sale. It's the same energy. The surprise Kate Spade sale.
He's at the Vera Bradley outlet and the wristlets are 50% off.
Whoa. Oh my gosh. Were you old enough to be there for the Vera Bradley era?
Well, here's the thing. Like, I was not participating, but I viewed it. Like, the moms
gotcha.
Swept them up. The Vera Bradley took the
yeah,
world by
so
storm.
Middle school. That was for me. Middle schoolers? Vera Bradley everything. And I'll say it, Vera Bradley is very comfy. Like, those purses, cozy. I mean, they're gonna get destroyed and disgusting because it was me and it's cloth, but they're like little quilts. And I do have one purse I look back on and I think about it. I'm like, I kind of liked that purse. It was very tiny and pink, which is very opposite of me and who I am today,
right?
But my grandparents, I in middle school, they'd ask me what I wanted, and I was like, Vera Bradley stuff, because that's what's in. And they proceeded for every single year from onward
Aww.
To give me a Vera Bradley item. So I have a Vera Bradley beach towel, lamp, pencils,
a lamp?
Sticky notes, a lamp.
Wow.
Yeah. A pool bag, another pool bag, a bigger bag. Yeah, I own a lot of Vera Bradley items.
Wow, this is a good background.
This is one of those things where you, like, tell somebody, hey, I like this, and they decide that that is your identity, and that is what you get from here on out. So, like, never tell anybody your favorite animal, because they'll just be like, especially if your favorite animal is a squirrel. I feel like squirrel people, you really corner yourselves, because there's
yeah.
so many squirrel items out there, and everyone wants to give it to you. I'm not a squirrel person. I just I don't know. I see it and I feel it for people.
Yeah.
I'm a squirrel sympathizer.
Wow.
It's a nut.
All right. Factory kids. This is where we get interesting. I have like two options for most of these. So first off, I think Charlie Bucket would be a real human child. But if we want to go on Muppet casting, Robin is the obvious choice. Robin's a bit of a blank slate. I think he's Kermit's nephew. But I also wanted to say, like, if we were using adult Muppets for all the kids, Kermit would be the right choice.
I love Robin.
Robin's really fucking cute.
Little frog. I guess I have a thing about cute little frogs. But he's just sitting there and he's so happy and I can hear
Elaine, you're going to get a bunch of frog shit next year.
Oh, no. Oh, no. You know what I really like? Gold. I love money.
I love money. Gift cards. I love money. Visa gift cards.
I love money. Money's my new personality thing. Just give me some money. Please. Go put it in a frame.
Please. Here. Robin's really fucking cute. He kind of could fit in the palm of your hand.
Stop. Is he really that small?
I mean, he's not that small, but he's a lot smaller than a lot of the other Muppets.
He's very cute.
So Elaine's had a journey and almost cried a little bit at seeing Robin.
Bullshit. Bullshit. I don't know what you're talking about. Bullshit. Okay. It's a podcast. No one can see me.
Augustus Gloop. Augustus.
Augustus Gloop.
Okay. We have two options here.
Whoa.
I wrote a lot of text. I wrote a full paragraph.
Whoa.
My options are Lou Zealand or Fozzie Bear. So the thing is, the Swedish chef is obvious, but I wanted to push past that. I thought, that's not inventive, and I want someone who could play a little younger. And my initial thought immediately, which shows my fucked up brain, was, oh, well, obviously, Lou Zealand. You know, the fish boomerang guy? Yeah, I don't think he ever talks. What? Which, granted, Augustus doesn't either.
What do you mean by fish boomerang
guy? His whole character is that he has a fish that he throws and it'll come back to him. That's Lou Zealand.
Is he trying to get rid of it?
Nope.
And it keeps coming back? Or he just
okay,
is like...
so the Muppets are like a vaudeville show, and that's his act.
Oh, okay. I see. Okay.
But he has this, like, red coat, and he has this, like, Shakespearean ruff around him.
Yeah.
And there's just something about him that reminds me of little Augustus, you know? Like,
He has a cute little red button nose and a little mustache. Yeah, there is Augustus energy here.
But our listener, Grace, who DM'd us about a potential Muppet casting only a few days prior, had picked out Fozzie for Augustus, which I didn't initially consider. Ooh. But I liked a lot because it makes the kids more core Muppets, which is good. I think we need core Muppets for the kids, you know?
I see a version where Fozzie, because Fozzie's whole thing is he's trying to be funny, a comedian, and his jokes just suck, yeah. Right? So, like, Fozzie trying to do a German accent similar to the way that I kind of try. I see that going well. And put Fozzie in a cute little outfit, and I do see that. But, like,
he, like, slips on a banana into the chocolate river.
Yes. I enjoy both of these.
Okay. Violet was really fucking hard. I think she's Pepe the Prawn. Now, hear me out. Hear me out, ladies and gents.
I hate this thing. I hate it.
Don't hate on Pepe.
It has Wendy's chicken nuggets for hands, and it has four arms.
He's a prawn. What do you want him to do?
Well, he looks too big for a prawn. He's up here and, like honestly wearing an outfit I've seen Drake wear, and then he has the tiniest little head. He looks like a mop.
Okay, so Pepe, he's kind of the womanizer of the Muppets.
What?
He's like a Spanish Lothario. Here's the thing. I also considered Ralph, because Violet is the most normal of the kids, and I wanted to address that. So I was like, who's somebody who can be kind of normal? But Ralph doesn't give a shit at all. He's just kind of above it all. Pretty, like, laid back. Like, would definitely listen to Jimmy Buffett. Do you know what I mean? Which I don't think Violet would, you know?
Yeah.
So there is a self-assuredness to Ralph, which is what I needed for Violet. I was looking for someone with the most self-assuredness. And I found that in Pepe. Because Pepe, I just thought, who of the Muppets would call out their rival on TV? And Pepe the Prawn would. Now Miss Piggy also would. But Miss Piggy isn't really Violet.
Fair.
You know, because if we're going to cast one of the kids as Miss Piggy, I think we know who it is. I don't think we need to say that. But I just thought Pepe is very, you know, self-assured. Like, he knows what he wants to do. He's a little obnoxious, but kind of normal at the end of the day.
Yeah, that fits the bill. I really cannot move past these chicken nugget hands. What, can you do the voice for me? What does Pepe sound like?
Oh, boy. I'm going to do a YouTube because I genuinely don't think I can do the Pepe voice.
Mm-hmm.
Kron's from space, a minute and 38 second video.
What?
Apparently he's from Spain.
Oh, hey, Carmen. Hey, when will you fix the oven, okay?
What's wrong with the oven?
There is a menu correction, okay? We will not be serving bologna sandwiches.
Wow.
Do you see what amazing. I mean? It's a weird vibe.
Yes.
But yeah, so that's Pepe, and that's Violet. I don't know, it's an odd choice, but I feel good about it, weirdly. Okay.
Yeah.
Now we have Veruca.
Oh.
So I said Miss Peggy, and I thought it was obvious, and I wanted to present an alternative. And my alternative is Animal.
Jesus.
Okay, now Veruca, kind of her whole thing is, I want it now. And I feel like you could do something with Animal just being like, want it now, you know? Because Animal just kind of repeats a few words over and over again.
I do enjoy that. Just kind of turning Veruca into this mindless, needy, shitty little machine of sorts.
Yeah. And if that happened, okay. Then I could consider Miss Piggy as Violet. You know what I mean?
Yes. Yes. I could see that.
I just think Miss Piggy is obvious. And if they did a Muppet movie about this, that's probably who it would be.
Yeah,
but Animal is very fun and worth considering, is my personal
opinion. I enjoyed you throwing that in there. I was a little shook. It was like I went to go take a bite of a taco and I didn't know it wasn't mild. It was level 3 spicy.
Yeah.
But then I enjoyed it after I had a good cry.
Exactly. And he's also red and Veruca wears red. So. And then Mike TV.
Oh, so
now,
so.
I thought Crazy Harry at first, but at the end of the day, Rizzo is the king of this. It's got to be Rizzo.
God.
Rizzo's like this New York, like, street smart Muppet.
Little rat.
Yeah, Rizzo's one of my favorite Muppets. He has, there was Rizzo's Pizza Place. He is a pizza place in Disney World, which replaced Pizza
Amazing.
Planet.
Is it still there?
I believe so.
Oh, I'm going in the fall.
You are?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
I can go check things out. If there's anything else like that, I can boots on the ground.
Just tell me about my boy Rizzo.
I will. I'll FaceTime you. We can have a dinner together. I'll mail you some.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. It's called Pizza Rizzo.
Pizza Rizzo. Oh, that's good.
It's remarkably close to the Star Wars land.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow. What a combo. What a combo.
Other things of note. What did I put here? Okay, this is what I said. I think Kermit as some sort of narrator for the story could work well. Like Gonzo in the Christmas Carol, he plays Charles Dickens and Rizzo just kind of hangs out
fantastic.
With them and they just like heckle it the whole time. And I feel like Kermit could be a similar role for this one. Maybe with some other compadre, I don't know who it would be, but somebody else who wasn't included could be fun. Mostly because then Kermit's involved. Because if Kermit's not involved, what are we doing, you know?
Yeah.
So this suggestion came from our listener, Grace. She suggested that the Oompa Loompas all be rats, which is so accurate because they do like normally play the ensemble role and they would probably do the same here. I love the Muppet rats so much. They make me so
happy. I see them being mischievous too. I don't know too much about them, but are they a little mischievous?
Oh,
I could see them getting up to some hijinks.
I love the Muppet rats so much. They make me so happy to look at.
Are they imprisoned in this photo?
This is from Muppets in Space that I haven't seen yet, but probably.
Oh, this is one of those ones you're holding off on seeing until 20 years from now.
Yeah. It's like the Shirley Jackson books. That and the Muppets.
Yes!
I spend those out.
That cracks me up so much. Your ability to wait for things is it's impressive.
It just means
impressive.
I never watch them is really what it is. All right. So Wonkas. I think overall, if we're thinking about a Muppet movie, and we're thinking of who would play Wonka in a Muppet movie, the answer is Gonzo. Like, if a Muppets movie was made for Wonka, it would have Gonzo as Wonka. But I wanted to expand my mind and see if there was accurate Wonka castings for each specific Wonka we cover on here. I did not do all of them. I only did the ones that stood out to me. So I want to be clear. If there was a Wonka Muppet movie made, Gonzo would play him. But...
yeah, I feel that.
If I'm casting specific, we get into it. And I have a bold take for my first one. Number one, I think Gene Wonka would be played by Miss Piggy. Now, hold on.
Oh, well.
Let me explain. My initial thought was Gonzo. But when I do these, I try really hard to go past my first instinct. And I realized the rage of Gene would be much better captured by Miss Piggy. Miss Piggy has an infernal rage to her, which Gonzo doesn't really have. And I didn't want to use the same Muppets for each character. And I thought, is there a person who could be better played by Gonzo, and I realized there was, which we'll talk about momentarily. But the thing that sold this for me is Miss Piggy is not as sentimental as the other Muppets, and Gonzo's pretty sentimental, all right? Gene isn't really that sentimental. He's like, you know what I mean? That depth is not needed there, and I just thought, I want to see Miss Piggy as Wonka.
That would be funny.
Like,
that would be pretty...
I stand good. By this mostly because of the rage, you know? She's a horrible singer. But Wonka doesn't do that much singing in this version, so I thought it'd be good.
That is perfect.
Have you ever heard Never Before, Never Again?
I don't know if I have. And where to find the words to sing its worth. When you can't see the puppet itself, I can only see a human in a recording booth doing this. And it's...
Oh my god.
I want a Miss Piggy Ave Maria moment. Like...
She has a duet with Celine Dion, too.
What? Can you imagine being like, I've done a duet with Celine Dion. They're like, yeah, can I hear it? I'm like, yeah, just so you know, though, I played it as Miss Piggy.
Okay, Johnny Wonka, hot takes. This bitch is Bean Bunny. He's Bean Bunny or Big Bird. And the problem with Johnny is he's not all that Muppety, so I was a little bit stuck here. But I really think he's Bean Bunny.
Tell me more about Bean Bunny. I don't know Bean Bunny.
So Bean Bunny, he was in like his own little special called like Bean Bunny's Holiday something or other, where he like makes friends with a dog. He's also in Muppet's Vision 3D. That's what I need you to see. I need you to see Muppet Vision 3D when you go to Disney.
What is that? Oh my. Oh,
Muppet Vision 3D.
This is a ride?
It's a theater experience. And you go in. You get to sit there and you watch like a 3D movie of the Muppets all hanging out and doing little shows and you get 3D stuff. It's a very fun like show. It's like 30 minutes. So if you don't have time for it, I understand. However, there's like this insane, I fucking hate this character and I want you to know I don't like it. There's this fucking awful like 3D. What is he? There's an original character for it who sucks and I want to warn you about him ahead of time. Okay. Waldo C. Graphic. I fucking hate this guy. He's terrifying and I want you to know he sucks before you go.
Oh. Ew. Wait, what? It's like, I don't even know how to describe it. It's like a ribbon tube hat. Nothing's connected. None of these body parts are connected. Its tail is a fucking butterfly, just like on the ass. It's got a dog tag for a bow tie. Teeth. Why does it have a top row of teeth?
Its nose Absolutely is coming out of its not. Eyes.
Or it's shooting blood.
It's like a virus. Horrible. It's fun. Anyway, that's Waldo C. Graphic, just warning you about him. But Bean Bunny in Muppet Vision 3D, Miss Piggy has a number where she's singing by a lakeside and he keeps fucking with her. But he had a good plan. He was like trying to spruce it up, so he like blows bubbles and then he accidentally gives her the handle to the ski, jet ski, that like pulls her across the water for a minute. But I don't know, Bean Bunny, he's known for being like very childish and like annoyingly cute, which is not how I feel about Johnny, but the way he talks is kind of Johnny-ish.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the same way I felt about Big Bird. Like, there's this trepidatiousness to the way they present themselves, you know?
That's fair, yeah. Big Bird's a little mysterious.
Yeah. So, I think Christian Wonka is Gonzo. All right?
Yes.
Because my first instinct was Gene is Gonzo and Christian is Miss Piggy. But I realized at the end of the day, Christian is so much more sentimental. I mean, the view from up here, you know.
That's fair.
Yeah, Gene doesn't have a moment like that. And Gonzo has that range for me. Have you ever heard I'm Going to Go Back There Someday? That song makes me
I'm sure
cry.
You played it for me at some point, but remind me.
I don't think I have. Here we go. Give it to me, Gonzo!
There's not a word yet for old friends who've just met. Part space.
Oh!
Or have I found my place?
Anyway.
There's not a word yet for old friends who just met.
I think about that line all the time.
Oh my god.
It's so good, right?
I felt that so in my core.
It's like that and Rainbow Connection. That's on my crying playlist.
Oh,
that's on my crying playlist. But yeah, no, I just kind of realized that Gonzo fit that, you know? Like, he could handle the view from up here, but he would also sing Whitney Houston.
Yes.
And you would do really the weird voices, casting. And it felt right.
Yeah.
Okay, so our Wonka, I think, would be played by Fozzie based on the fart shoe principle. And the fart shoe principle is a principle I developed where I'm like, who is a character that would wear fart shoes during a pivotal moment and ruin the vibe for everybody? This is how I cast Fozzie as Tom Wamsgans in Succession. And Wilfred Wonka would wear fart shoes at a pivotal moment and ruin the vibe 100%. For everybody. And Fozzie's life as a monetarily successful but shitty comedian is very in line with Wilfred Wonka. Like, that's so in line with our vision. And it wasn't like I was like, oh, he's Wilfred. That's a great... Like, I felt kind of reluctant to admit that he was Fozzie, but he is.
Yes.
Also, this feels like a good time to address...
Oh, yeah.
So, guys... On the episode where we gave all the Wonka's first names, we named our Wonka Willard. And that's Willard, not true. Yeah. His we corrected that over the time by just making him either Wilford or Wilfred. Either or is fine.
By accident, I'd like to.
By accident.
We didn't pre-think it. We just said Wilford, and then that's just what happened.
What's
and
stuck then we realized,
what, two episodes ago? We're like, wait, shit.
Did we fuck this up?
Willard.
And no one's called us out for it, but I just wanted to bring it to everyone's attention that he is formerly Wilford or Wilfred. Doesn't matter which.
I think mostly I forget they're two separate names.
True. Wilford, fair enough.
I love this, though. I 100% agree with Fozzie.
I just felt like that was a good time to address the snafu we've made.
Yes. Yes.
All right.
Our public service announcement.
His name is Wilford, and we fucked it up
our
the first time.
Our NOSAP apology is coming soon.
So we can say that Roald Wonka is Willard, and it's fine, and it's fixed. Even if that doesn't feel right, it's righted itself, okay?
Yes,
put it on the wiki. Yes. That's not true. We don't have a wiki.
Update our wiki.
Lastly, Timmy Wonka is being played by Walter. Walter from the 2011 Muppet movie. We need a grounded Muppet. And Walter may not be as self-assured as Wonka is, but he has that boundless positivity that Timothy Chalamet keeps asserting his Wonka has. It's almost like he's insecure about it.
You ain't wrong. I love this so much. This is a Muppet I know because I did watch the Muppet movie with Felicia, and this is the main character in that movie. He's so cute.
I'm Googling Muppet Vision 3D so I can watch it after we finish recording. Sorry, just wanted to know.
Do you do that? We'll talk about things, and then I'll type it really quickly into my browser and pin them so I can circle back and, like, watch
just
them or whatever.
Leave the
like,
tabs
or
open.
You'll say something, and I'm like, what the fuck is that? Okay, cool. And I just save it for later, and I don't mention it sometimes.
We both Google. I looked up the movie Snow Dogs, and we were talking before recording, and I was like, fair enough. There's something when you find someone else who, as you can see, you're talking to them, you can see them do a context Google. Oh, it's so refreshing because I'm like, oh, you're
it's
just
so
like me.
Good.
You get it. Save us a conversation.
I'm so glad for it.
But yeah, so that's my Muppet cast. I mean,
this was fantastic, and I appreciate the time you put into this because I can see how this would be really hard. And we have so many different personalities, but again, there's some like overlap. And I think you did a really good job, and especially as someone who doesn't fully know the Muppets, like, you know, as you were going into it, I was like, that makes sense. I agree.
Thank you. So, I'm glad to hear that. It was harder than I thought it would be. It was a lot harder than I thought it would be. You know, and I'm gonna have a lot of fun editing the episode covers because I'm really good at editing Muppets into scenarios. It's a skill of mine.
So good. I'm hoping, and I think it'll be easier to Muppet cast the upcoming Wonka movie.
I kind of feel like
we have
will
a lot of
too.
Muppet vibe. Like, whoever Keegan-Michael Key is playing, like, is a Muppet. So
exactly.
I feel like there's some solid vibe. So I cannot wait for us to return to this.
Yes.
And to learn more. Maybe I'll learn more Muppet lore between now and then.
We'll see. Maybe we'll
probably
make
not.
Her watch a second Muppet movie.
Wait,
I have to
watch
Anastasia before
movie?
We make you watch the Muppet movies.
What do you mean have to? Oh, okay. I was like, you get to. I turned 29 and I made everyone on my birthday watch Anastasia with me while I provided commentary.
Yeah. I love that.
It was fantastic. It was so fun.
Well, I think that's about it. We have to do predictions now, don't we?
Prequel predictions.
Yeah, prequel predictions.
I have one ready
you
to
do?
Go.
Wow.
I think at some point Wonka's gonna whistle, and that was inspired by seeing Walter.
That is a fantastic prediction, man.
I feel really good about that.
That feels
really
good.
It's been
good.
A while since I've had a good one.
That feels really good, Elaine.
I feel rejuvenated from that.
Someone's gonna sell knockoff Wonka products in the film.
Ooh, I love
I feel
that.
Like there's a chance of that. Like, one of the people is trying to steal his ideas, and it's clearly, so clearly his packaging, you know? Like the Gourmand Yusuf Petrichor III Wonka perfume debacle.
As we all know, that historical event.
That historic battle. So we've covered everything we need to cover. So I want to thank everybody for listening to this episode and give you some little reminders. If you want to follow us, you can do so on Instagram and TikTok at WonkaWatch, and you can email us with all your questions and concerns at WonkaRapture@gmail.com. If you want to support the podcast, well, there's two things you can do. One, you can tell people about us, because that helps a shit ton and we love it. And the second thing you can do is you can support us and join our membership at buymeacoffee.com/WonkaWatch. When you join there, you get access to a bunch of weird shit, like our Muppet commentary track, a bunch of other shit we worked on the Game Boy Advance from last week, Elaine's insane album, and when you also join, we do a little song for you. And today we have three people to sing the praises of. So Elaine, do you want to read out the little messages and names?
Sure. We have Amanda Brewer, who said, "Love your content." Thank you. We have someone, oh, I'm going to have so much fun singing that, someone who said, "Proud to be a Wonka scholar. We're glad to have you in the academy." And then we have Neil, who said, "You are my favorite podcast at the moment, just deeply chaotic and delightful. I listen to you every day at work while I water all the plants, LOL." I would love to think of some chaotic place that isn't like a garden center where Neil works watering all the plants, like a zoo. Yeah. The nocturnal exhibit at the zoo.
The Eiffel Tower. Perhaps
the Eiffel Tower nocturnal
Louvre.
Oh, the zoo. Oh, this is gonna be wild. Okay.
All right, you ready? No, we got some shit royalty free French background music. We played 3 seconds of it and went, "Oh, this fucking sucks. We gotta use it." So you're welcome, guys.
Here we go. Oh, look, there is someone. And that someone is coming around the corner. And they have a baguette. Oh, do not forget that this is always for our friend Neil. Neil is watering the plants. Amanda is stomping on the plants. They do not like each other, but with a second glance, they realize that maybe they could be friends. Because someone out there is a friend of theirs. And Amanda, a brewer, don't fight her. She knew her worth, and that is why she is here in France. Oh, Paris. Oh, les Champs-Élysées. Oh, for Neil, it is juste. Mwah, parfait. These lovely little trios, so silly, so amigos. Love them forever. Thank you in France.
Wow. That was amazing. Whoa. We just need things that, like, you make a story. I want to let you know that while that was playing, there was on the video, I had a bunch of stock footage of France, and one of the videos was a man walking with a blanket just through a park.
What?
Just an old man with a blanket going through a park. Well, that was great.
Wow.
Well, thank you, everybody.
Thank y'all for joining. I really enjoyed playing with someone. That was...
Yeah.
Well,
I mean, this episode was... This is, like, Wonka's second cousin. Fourth cousin, let's be real. This is not a second cousin.
Let's be real.
Happy birthday to me. I'm still not 20 when this episode releases, but I will be soon.
Oh, may you... No, I was going to wish that you turned into a Muppet, but that's a really weird thing that's actually that I wouldn't put upon you.
You also said I would turn into dust at the beginning of this episode. I'm sorry.
I already forgot about that.
But yeah, at the end of the day, this episode really, truly was not that important. I don't even have, like, a caveat normally where I'm like, this felt important. No, nothing about this felt important. It was just, we had a nice Muppet discussion.
Felicia,
it felt like a nice
break. I'm glad you're here. It was a nice break, and you're important. You're so important.
Thank you.
But this Muppet casting just really wasn't.
No, it truly was
But it was
not.
Beautiful. But it's so
what? It felt like a little vacation for us.
When people go, "How are you able to have 84 episodes of the Wonka Watch podcast?" This.
You get real fucking loosey-goosey with what constitutes Wonka-related content.
Can't wait for Vanity Fair to quote us with all our intel. But unfortunately, it's just...
Where's the GQ profile of Hermit the Muppet?
AskMen.com.
Bye, guys. It's not that important. Bye.
A tout à l'heure. À bientôt.
Bye.